Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to the fourth and final session of the Capitalist Mode of Power series. This series has received the kind sponsorship of the Department of Political Science and the Graduate Program in Social and Political Thought. If you have missed any of the previous presentations, I encourage you to visit capitalaspower.com, as these presentations will be posted on the website. In any case, today I have the privilege of introducing to you Troy Cochrane. Troy is a PhD student in the graduate program in Social and Political Thought. He has published a number of book chapters and articles on a whole range of subjects, from anti-apartheid struggle in South Africa to the political economy of oil, and from the US subprime mortgage crisis to the radical political philosophy of Cornelius Castoriadis. Troy will have about 45 minutes to speak, and after his presentation, we will have a question and answer session.
Thank you all for coming. The title of my talk is The Power of Love, Diamonds in the Accumulation of De Beers. And we're going to start with the very first sentence of my abstract, which is, through the early 20th century, the power of the De Beers diamond cartel was dwindling. Okay, so I want to call attention to two words. The first is the word power, which is perhaps one of the most contentious words in the social sciences. And the second is the word dwindling, which implies a quantitative aspect to power. And this is a common construction that one sees in social scientific writing, and it's usually offered without any sort of development. There's an implicit, unqueried quantification, and you see this through every social scientific discipline, people referring to power ebbing and flowing, waxing and waning. So that raises the question of how is power measured? And the quick and dirty answer is capitalization. And three things to note about capitalization is that it's financial, and as Nitzan and Bickler write, capital is finance and only finance, and capital is finance and only finance because capital is a mechanism of capitalization. Capitalization is differential. One of the primary insights of capitalist power is that capitalization becomes meaningful relative to some benchmark. And capitalization is dynamic. It's constantly being calculated and recalculated. And unlike metaphorical benchmarks, which provide us with a fixed measure against which something can be compared, capitalization benchmarks are themselves dynamic. So capitalization is used to understand the shifting valuation against a shifting sea of valuation. And with this understanding of capitalization dynamically recalculated, there's a better word for the measure of changing power: accumulation. So capitalization is the mechanism, and accumulation is the goal. And here we're understanding the quantities of accumulation. So our question was, how is power measured? Power is measured by quantities of accumulation, or more precisely, drawing from capital as power, by quantities of differential accumulation. So coming finally to De Beers. This chart has three series. The thick black line, or all three series, are the indexed values, where 1938 to 1940 is set equal to 100. And this indexes the market capitalization. So I've compared De Beers to three benchmarks. And these three benchmarks represent important arenas where De Beers operated. So we have the South African mines, which was an important source of stones. We have the Bankers Index, which is an index of stocks traded on the London Stock Exchange, which was the financial center for De Beers and where it traded. And we have the S&P 500, which is primarily American, US American corporations. And that's where most of De Beers' product was sold. To the left of the World War II indication, it's worth noting that each point is every 5 years, and each point is a 10-year moving average. And this is because I wanted to give a picture of the long-term trend for De Beers. So if you looked at every year, there's a lot of dramatic up and down, but the long-term trend was one of decline. And the decline of De Beers is steeper and more protracted than that of bankers and the South African mines. And over the same time period, the S&P 500 was largely increasing. So differentially, De Beers was losing ground. So that's what I mean when I say, through the early 20th century, the power of the De Beers diamond cartel was dwindling. My next sentence reads, its resurrection came with World War II. And we can see that De Beers greatly outpaced all of the benchmarks in its accumulatory gain. So this is the empirical evidence. Capitalist power has provided a measure of power that allows me to state that their power was dwindling, to speak about power in quantitative terms. My analytical claim is that this quantitative measure is a measure of power, power lost and power gained. Before going any further, I think we need to be clear on the analytical role of power. Power does not explain. Power is what must be explained. Social asymmetries exist, and we need to understand where they came from. Those social asymmetries constitute power, and using power as an explanation results in a tautology. So what capital's power does is it gives us a measure of power. It gives us tools for mapping the shifting topology of social asymmetry. So power is measured by quantities of differential accumulation. That power now needs to be explained. And that raises the question, what does accumulation measure? Power can't be our answer, because then we're in that tautology of power measuring power. Standard theories of accumulation rely on a dual quantity. Financial quantities are a distorted representation of underlying real quantities. Capitalist power rejects any existence of some sort of underlying objective determinant of nominal financial quantities. Financial quantities are rather the emergent construction of a pricing process that translates qualities into quantities. So this raises two additional questions. What are the qualities of accumulation? And the prior question, how are the qualities of accumulation measured? And this one I'll deal with very briefly. So the measurement of accumulation, it's distributed, meaning the pricing process occurs within numerous calculative centers. It's intersubjective. Those centers are filled with many different individuals, each constructing a price. It's quasi-objective. It's not strictly objective. There's not some given determinant or set of determinants for prices. But they're also not just pulled out of thin air. Rather, there's a selective, agglomerative process that moves information towards buyers and sellers. And it's their activities of buying and selling that create the values of capital. So participants employ insiders, experts, analyst reports, engineering reports, news reports, popular formulas like black scholes, cutting-edge proprietary algorithms, generally accepted accounting principles, Bloomberg terminals, Excel, SAS, PCs, CPUs, electricity, fiber optics. All of these are part of the massive assemblage that is used to measure the qualities of accumulation. Measurement is ongoing. It never sleeps. It's interdependent, meaning it's not independent from what is measured. And it's indeterminate. There is not some true or real price out there that nominal values kind of dance around. There are instead many alternative prices that will be continually adjusted in the wake of new information, including the emergence of prices in each round. And those reassessments will be recollated once again for a new emergent price. So So now we return to, what are the qualities of accumulation? So coming back to our chart, what were the changing qualities that led to this? What did De Beers' increased power actually consist of? So briefly returning to the abstract, we can say that it consisted of confidence in obedience. And this is Knitzen and Bickler's definition of power. As well, they, along with many other social scientists, emphasize that power is a relationship. So my interpretation is that power exists in stabilized relationships of control. A stabilized entity's behavior can be expected probabilistically. And it's worth noting that the mechanisms of control differ. So we know that a subordinate will follow an order. A lobbyist will likely succeed in achieving a policy change. An oil well will produce a predictable amount of oil. A certain proportion of the public will buy a product in response to an ad campaign. So to increase power, we can increase obedience, or we can increase confidence. Understanding power as a relation, I think we can take this to mean, to increase power, we can expand relations. So an actor becomes powerful as it extends and multiplies its reach, confident in its control over ever more entities, drill new wells, affect more policies, entice more sales. Or we can stabilize relations. It becomes more certain of the effectiveness of its reach, increase customer loyalty, reduce oil well accidents, hire a former politician as a lobbyist. And two things I'd like to note. These relations have to have some effect on the so-called elementary particles of capitalization to be accounted for. For example, they have to be expected to increase expected earnings or decrease risk. Second, with respect to differential accumulation, these efforts need to exceed the efforts of one's fellow capitalists. There's no ontological restriction on which relationships will count in the accumulatory struggle. So for example, production is just one piece, an important piece, but just one piece. There are relations with infrastructure, politicians, media, technologies, bureaucrats, employees. And understanding this lack of ontological restrictions should undermine any impulse to deterministic analysis. All actors must work to become powerful and stay powerful. And that work will enroll an indeterminate roster of entities. So returning once again to De Beers. What sort of relations did De Beers expand and stabilize to reverse its waning fortune? And today we'll consider four. Relations with romantic couples, relations with governments, relations with wartime manufacturing, and relations with diamonds themselves. Now, each of these objects has a tempting correspondence with existing analytical categories. So wartime production, typically we would consider that economics. Governments, that belongs to politics. Romantic couples, that's psychology, or some would say biology, or maybe sociology, or maybe cultural studies. And then diamonds are geology. And to these analytical distinctions, there's even more foundational intellectual bifurcation, where economics, the politics, psychology are all considered social, while geology belongs to the natural. And I think accumulation studies has to eschew even these reified categorizations, because regardless of the categorizations, all get translated into the quantities of accumulation. We'll begin with romantic couples. So I want to point out that giving diamond engagement rings predated De Beers' advertising. diamonds were already the most popular stone for engagement rings at about 1/3 of all rings. The second most popular was pearls. It wasn't the sort of singular tradition that it is now, where if you have an engagement ring that's something other than a diamond, you're immediately telling people that you are a certain sort of person, and that's going to provoke questions. Oh, why didn't you get a diamond? It's just assumed that an engagement ring will contain a diamond. That was not the case, although diamonds were the most popular engagement gem. So for De Beers to forge its relationship, it made use of advertising. And this is its first advertisement. This is from late summer of 1939. Previously, all diamond advertising was done by jewelers in the context of ads for their services. These were different in that they were general ads for diamonds, just for diamonds. And you might notice that De Beers' brand name does not figure prominently in the ad. So, on advertising, I think it should be noted that De Beers' ads were not logically necessary. There was no structural force making them advertise. De Beers doesn't even sell cut diamonds. They don't even sell to jewelers. They could have done many other things in response to their waning fortunes. They did not have to advertise. Now, that's not to say that there weren't structures in place that guided and facilitated their choice to advertise. What I am saying was that there was a choice, and that choice matters. It had consequences for accumulation, although that can't be proven reductively. And it has consequences beyond accumulation. For example, the current diamond engagement tradition, which I think is born here. Both the form and the content of the ads matter. De Beers' ads shouldn't be considered an undifferentiated member of advertising in general, which has been the standard political economic approach to advertising. Advertising is a process relative to capitalization as a whole, and it gets analyzed itself as a whole. Particular ads, such as those of De Beers, are given no political economic consideration. That would be the domain of cultural studies, perhaps. And I'm saying these particularities matter. So in the matter of form, here I'm comparing that De Beers ad to another ad from the same issue of Life magazine. I think the first thing that jumps out is the amount of white space in the De Beers ad. And graphic designers refer to white space as the ultimate luxury. So it's reasonable, both of these are inside the magazine, neither is on a back cover. So the cost of the ad was probably the same. It's a full page ad. RCA made the most of their space. They jam-packed it with text. And although by today's standards, the De Beers ad is very text-heavy, it's actually quite sparse by the standards of its era. It's also very clean. It has far fewer fonts. The RCA ad might have a half dozen different fonts and far fewer font sizes. And again, it doesn't have a prominent brand name compared to RCA. Now consider the content. The beginning of the ad reads, "A young man, just engaged, is apt to share subconsciously the poet's state of mind. He perceives a world of unsuspected beauties, a future in which the golden age is reborn in one predestined couple." This sort of florid, romantic language has to be contrasted with the hyped technologies of the jam-packed RCA ad, which proclaimed, "The RCA Victor has not six, not seven, but eight tubes. Not six, not seven, but eight buttons." And this romantic appeal that De Beers, on the other hand, was making, again contrasting it from other ads of the era, was connected to engagement. And it goes on to say, "There are many things a man must consider when undertaking one of his lifetime's most important purchases, his diamond engagement ring. Each man owes it to his future to give the most beautiful diamond he can buy." This speaks to aspiration. This ad is invoking the American dream. Regardless of who you are, buy for who you wish to be. Buy for your future self. The ring should be a symbol of the future, a promise that the man is making to himself and the promise that he's making to his bride to be. It goes on. There are but a few simple rules for its selection. Go to a reliable jeweler. Diamond prices vary with weight, color, quality, and cutting. Now, jewelers are an important part of De Beers' relationship with romantic couples, and we'll talk about that in a moment. Now, anyone who knows anything about diamonds probably knows the so-called four C's: carat, cut, clarity, and color. We can see that in 1939, that marketing label had not yet been created. But the intention was already there. So weight would become carat, and quality would become clarity to give us the easily understood and remembered four C's. And it was very important for these ads to teach possible buyers about these four axes determining price. They wanted to move the emphasis away from size alone. The ad states, "This table will guard you from dubious bargains." So they included representative sizes and the range of prices for those sizes. And they again repeat the four axes determining price, explicitly stating that, quote, "size alone does not determine diamond value." I think it's interesting that they refer to value rather than price. And they claim that they're citing an average from prices reported by jewelers. Now, the dubious bargains that they're talking about are seen here. Prior to De Beers advertising, there were mail-in order diamond services. And if you recall, you probably didn't pay too much attention, but the De Beers ad cited $325 to $600 for 1 carat stone unmounted. The dubious bargains being offered are for $70 to $225 per carat unmounted, or mounted. And De Beers and the jewelers believed such ads were undermining people's diamond knowledge, and they had to be counteracted. And this was the role for jewelers. They were to be the trusted source of stones rather than such dubious sources. Both the jewelers and De Beers shared in a desire for a knowledgeable customer. So returning to my claim that the advertising was not logically necessary, these ads were creations. They constituted something new added into the world. They were not predetermined. And on this point, I think it's important to turn to Castoriadis, who stresses that there is no necessary normative component to creation. Today, we tend to think of creation as inherently something good. Castoriadis makes the point that both Beethoven's Fifth and Auschwitz were creations. There's nothing inherently normative in the act of creation itself. So acknowledging that these ads were creations, something new added to the world, is not to claim that, oh, well, therefore they were good. Castoriadis tells us that creation is ex nihilo, meaning there's a radically new emergent quality to all creations. Try as you might, you're not going to find that newness prior to the act of its creation. However, he stresses that creation is not in nihilo, meaning I'm not saying there's no foundation to it, that there's no ingredients that are used in the act of creation. And he says creation is not cum nihilo, meaning he's not saying there's no constraints. So a nuclear reactor couldn't have emerged from medieval Europe. So there are both constraints and ingredients, but there's always this ex nihilo emergent component. And I think we need to understand De Beers' ads this way. There is an emergent aspect to it, but there were ingredients and constraints on those ads. Those ads were carefully and painstakingly constructed and added to the world, but they were not constructed out of nothing. So I said that advertising was the key to the relationship between De Beers and romantic couples, but prior to that advertising, there was an important role for market research. So De Beers advertising agency, NW Air, conducted two surveys in 1938, one with jewelers and one with prospective diamond buyers. The findings from that market research were compiled into a report for De Beers before its campaign began. One example of the findings, 75% of the unit volume in diamond jewelry and 70% of the dollar value consists of diamond engagement rings, and the jewelers refer to engagement rings as their bread and butter line. And that the unit volume is higher than the dollar amount indicates that the per unit price for engagement rings is lower than that for other diamond jewelry. And Ayer didn't simply report their findings, they analyzed it, and they state, the fact that the typical amount invested in the purchase of an engagement ring is as low as, should be is here indicated, suggests the need for persuading young men to spend a larger amount for the jewel. So we can see an ingredient to the aspirational aspect of the eventual ads. So telling men that they're buying a diamond for their future self is a way of enticing them to spend more on the diamonds. It did not have to be that way. They did not have to invoke the American dream. They could have just said, hey, loser, spend more money. But they had a slightly more creative way of getting the same effect. So this report constructed a diamond market, the idea of a diamond market. It wasn't just to gather inputs for the campaign, although it did that. It was also used to convince De Beers that a campaign would be useful. The report was not a strict relay between jewelers and consumers and De Beers. The survey results were translated to construct a certain idea of the diamond market, which is not to say that the construction was not real. It's to say that there wasn't an actual diamond market out in the world simply waiting for De Beers to tap into it. Rather, there was a market to be constructed, including through the use of the market research and this report. We could say that the market in this report and the market to be constructed were quasi-objective creations. The construction that they offered was of a public enamored with diamonds, but whose interest was waning or turning elsewhere. Diamonds were preferred to other gems, but they came in second best against other luxuries, such as automobiles or trips abroad. Other ads that we won't look at here highlight the durability of diamonds compared to other luxuries, noting how flowers wilt and die. And eventually, this would become the famous slogan, "A diamond is forever." So although that slogan was a radically new creation, we can already see some of the ingredients in the report from 1938. The researchers also found a public lacking knowledge about diamond prices. So they state that in estimating the cost of the stones, they had sample stones for people to look at and guess how much they would cost, there is a wide margin of error, and the tendency is toward underestimation, perhaps from being exposed to the mail order diamond services. This popular belief that good quality diamonds cost far less than is actually the case makes it more difficult for the honest jeweler to impress his prospects that his prices for diamond jewelry are not exorbitant. So we can see the interest that jewelers had in this campaign. So the informational table that I showed you was aimed at educating buyers. So we can see how that component of the ad has part of its ingredients here in this report. However, not every jeweler was happy with the table. NW Air received numerous complaints that the price table was actually De Beers imposing its prices on jewelers. If you were a jeweler who wanted to charge more than the table dictated, then you probably were going to be seen as ripping off consumers. And contrary to what people's belief might be, De Beers' main interest wasn't pushing the price of diamonds as high as they possibly could. It was keeping it very, very stable. The ads also responded to the changing world. And the biggest change, obviously, was World War II. So here's an ad from 1943. Now, De Beers did not pretend the war didn't exist, which they could have done. They could have taken a romantic escapist route. Instead, they incorporated the war into the ads. To me, there's no mistaking that she is gazing across the ocean to the distant theaters of war, where presumably her loved one is. And the text on top reads, "A little light, so constant and so sweetly clear, it finds his heart across the widest waters and hours of loneliness. That is the diamond on her finger, an ever-fixed beacon, pledged to safe homecomings and fair rewards in their new life to be." So although times are difficult, the diamond is a sign of both commitment and an end to war. So we all know the diamond engagement tradition. So obviously De Beers had some success. However, its success was not a simple matter of enticing greater sales of diamonds, or not simply a matter of enticing greater sales of diamonds. This chart has three series on it. The thick black line is US marriages per 1,000 women. The black dotted line is the US import of rough stones. And De Beers sells rough stones, not cut stones. And the white dotted line is US imports of cut stones. So recall that their advertising began in 1939, the same year as the start of World War II. So initially, marriages take off, setting new records for the US. Over the same time period, the US import of rough stones barely rose. Well, the imports of cut stones actually fell. So although marriages are increasing, we're not seeing any commensurable increase in the import of diamonds. Imports jump in 1943 while the marriage rate falls. And in fact, I believe that import in both cut and rough stones has more to do with people who've managed to escape continental Europe, the occupation of continental Europe, have finally been able to export their diamonds from England, which had pretty stringent export controls. And so they were exporting them to the US for safekeeping, not to satisfy a growing demand for diamonds. I think the vital year for the diamond tradition is 1946. So the soldiers return home, and they're relatively affluent because they've been earning soldiers' salaries and not spending the money on much. Money is getting sent home to satisfy their wives, but for these soldiers, they're coming back single with money to spend. And we can see that a record-setting year for marriages corresponds to a record-setting importation of cut diamonds. Now, again, De Beers didn't sell cut diamonds. So De Beers was not, I mean, they were the beneficiaries because they sold the rough stones that became those cut stones. But it was the cut stones that were there to satisfy the demand because of this jump in marriages. So De Beers' benefit is less the immediacy of this act than the birth of the tradition. It's these years, because 1947 is also a record-setting year apart from 1946, that is the real beginning of the singular diamond tradition. Now diamond has gone from simply being the most popular engagement stone to being the stone for an engagement. This is the reason why your grandmothers, possibly great-grandmothers, had diamond engagement rings. So the effect of the ads was much more subtle, complex, and diffuse than simply enticing sales. A faltering tradition important to the accumulation of De Beers was stabilized and extended. So quickly going back to the ad, I want us to look at a blurb in the lower right-hand corner that reads, "Industrial diamonds, a key priority for high-speed war production, come from the same mines as gemstones. The occasional gem diamond found among them helped defray production costs for all those fierce little fighting diamonds." So to those contemplating getting a diamond, don't fret that this is some sort of indulgent luxury. In fact, buying diamonds helps the war effort. So again, this is an effort to expand the idea of diamonds and stabilize sales. Now, the blurb is not untrue, although the relationship between gem and industrial diamonds is hardly so simple. Most gem mining had ceased with the war. Gem rough stones were being sold from an existing stockpile. Industrial stones were still being mined, but they were coming largely from the Belgian Congo that produced very few gem diamonds. The producers in the Belgian Congo were Belgian companies that sold their diamonds through De Beers. And part of keeping those companies in the participating in the cartel was actually buying their gems off them at elevated prices. So De Beers was paying more for these diamonds than they were actually worth in order to control the diamond trade. So by buying these gemstones, in many ways, you were helping simply to prolong the cartel. So they've raised the industrial issue, so we'll move to considering De Beers' relationship with wartime manufacturing. And that relationship is defined by wartime use, but also by De Beers' marketing, meaning their entire sales effort, their advertising, plus everything that went into the process of supplying diamonds to the diamond trade. So industrial stone use, demand for stone skyrocketed with war. So again, we have three series here. And each series is indexed for 1931 to 1940. And this is to allow us to compare the relative use of these inputs during the war compared to previous to the war. So the thick black line is diamonds. The white dotted line is steel. The black dotted line is copper. So during the war, the use of steel and copper increased 2 and 2.5 times respectively, while the use of diamonds increased 9 times. And as much as the quantitative change is important, this also evidences a qualitative change. So diamonds were being entered into more and more manufacturing processes. The hardness of stones made them vital for wartime manufacturing. They keep shape for longer at higher speeds. So industrial diamonds were not forever. They get worn out and destroyed through use. But the same hardness that would inform the slogan made them this vital and even irreplaceable input. They were important for cutting and shaping steel and rubber. They enabled more precise metalworking. Manufactories could increase the pace, scale, and precision of their output. And they're irreplaceable for drawing fine wires. So you can use a diamond, you bore a very small hole in a series of diamonds where the hole gets smaller and smaller and smaller, and you take a piece of copper and you draw it through these dies, getting ever thinner. And the dies wear out very, very quickly. If it's anything other than diamond, the diamond can hold its shape longer than any other material. And no other material can be used at all for the finest gauges of wire. And World War II was a high-tech war. It was using communication technologies and radar that hadn't been used previously. And these all made extensive use of the fine wire that only diamond could be used to produce. So the diamond was an irreducible component of the war. Industrial diamonds were deemed an essential input. De Beers refused to provide a stockpile to the US. So the US was stockpiling all of the inputs that manufactories needed that it didn't have its own source of. And it didn't have its own source of diamonds, so it wanted a stockpile of industrial stones, and De Beers refused to provide that because they were worried that a stockpile would undermine supply control. So supply control had been their means of controlling the diamond trade to their favor since the cartel was secured in 1889. And industrial stones were becoming increasingly important to the cartel. Previously treated as a byproduct, De Beers began much more actively marketing industrials. And here we're looking at US imports of gem and industrial diamonds, which I've used as a rough proxy for De Beers' sales of gem and industrial diamonds, because I can't get a consistent series for those sales figures. I've also imputed the gem amount by adding together the import of rough stones by the import of gemstones adjusted for the adjusted for the price of rough. Because remember, De Beers doesn't sell cut, they sell rough. So from 1937 to 1942, we can see that while the import of gems dropped almost 20% per year, industrials increased almost 30%. And the import share for gems was falling. So industrials were becoming much more important to De Beers. They wouldn't provide the US with a stockpile, but they promised not to raise industrial stone prices. They supported research and development of diamond tools, which was obviously also in their interest. And eventually, they agreed to a stockpile held in Canada. So this is the agreement related to the establishment of a reserve of industrial diamonds upon the North American continent. Now, this was an agreement among nation states. However, De Beers was also an explicit participant in the agreement. The agreement included a provision referring to the agreement with producers. So the UK reached an agreement with De Beers on the provision of stones, and then the UK was signing this agreement really on behalf of itself and De Beers. So here they cite certain diamond producers, some of which were subsidiaries of De Beers, others of which marketed their stones through De Beers, the Diamond Corporation, a subsidiary of De Beers, and the Diamond Trading Corporation, a subsidiary of De Beers. Importantly, it also references the sorting of material. So it states, adequate arrangements will be made to ensure that the reserve is sorted into the usual assortments of the Diamond Corporation. So the way that De Beers classifies the stones that it gathers, this reserve will maintain that classification. We'll talk about that. So De Beers' relationship with diamonds. Now, its relationship took place in terms of locating the stones, extracting the stones, and sorting the stones, but we're going to focus on the sorting. So De Beers sorted according to shape, size, color, and clarity. And this was important for the way they sold the diamonds. So they have all the diamonds that have been mined come to a central location. They're then sorted according to these criterion. And they're sorted along a gradient. And that gradient is what determines prices. So you have a large stone that has no internal flaws and is a great shape for cutting, that's a very expensive stone. If you have a small stone that has a lot of cracks running through it, and it's very rough and cloudy on the surface and very difficult to cut, that's a very cheap stone. So they have a certain mix of qualities. So say 10% of their stones are high quality, 50% are low quality, and 40% are middling. If you're a diamond buyer, you come to what are called sites, and there are, I think, 13 sites a year, and you're offered a box that contains diamonds. The mix of diamonds in that box represents, or is kind of a slice, off the total stock of diamonds that De Beers holds. So it will have 10% high quality stones, 40% middling, 50% garbage. And this is a take it or leave it process. You accept this box at the price De Beers says, or you walk away from the whole thing. There's no cherry picking and choosing which diamonds you want. And leaving a box could mean your buying privileges were done. You would never have an opportunity again, short of groveling on bended knee. On that. So this was called a series. Stones were sold in a series. So this is a US Department of Justice document detailing De Beers categories. So they had four broad gem categories and one broad industrial category. Under the gem categories, there was 211 subcategories, and under the industrial categories, there was 49 subcategories. So the first sort is into gem and industrial. Now, it should be said that these categories are not natural, but neither are they strictly social. Sorting stones is a privileged, skilled position, and the grading occurs in dialogue with the stones. Diamonds were irreducible participants in the sorting, and the sort has accumulatory consequences, as it alters the possible profits from a stone. If a stone is mistakenly sorted into a lower grade, it gets priced lower. On the other hand, an overly generous assessment of stones might provoke a backlash from buyers if they are all considering that they're being charged too much. So individually, they were relatively powerless. Occasionally, collectively, they would push back. And the determination of gem or industrial at the margins between them was determined by the state of demand for gemstones. If demand for gems was higher, more stones would get that classification. I'm going to skip this. Now, industrials were also sorted according to color and clarity, and they were also sold in this sort of series. And this was a source of contention with industrial stone users. They claimed that this kind of sort, the sort that De Beers had developed on the basis of selling stones to be cut for gems, was meaningless for industrial stones. And they instead would resort the stones according to their use. So certain stones would be appropriate for drawing wire, certain stones would be appropriate for mining drill bits, certain stones would be appropriate for cutting steel. They also complained that the selection offered effectively raised prices. So by keeping a higher quantity, by including a higher quantity of lower quality stones, the quality assessed by usefulness, while charging the same price, keeping their promise, De Beers could effectively raise the price. And these complaints eventually led the US Department of Justice to initiate an investigation. So now we come to De Beers' relationship with governments. And this, breaking with how I've done it before, I'm going to say that that relationship is differential, meaning they had different relationships with different governments. So just briefly, can we talk about government relations with sort of a capital in general? Now, I think at the very least we can say that all capitalist governments backstop capitalization and accumulation. They at least provide the rules for capitalization and accumulation. And this is contrary to the standard political economic treatment of that relationship, which tells us that state and capital have this certain kind of relationship and it's marked by these certain patterns of behavior. And I think, in fact, we need much more empirically based study on what the relevant relationship is between capitalist governments in general and capital understood in terms of capitalization. So returning to the differential government relations, we have different governments, obviously, and we have different corporations, and we have different corporate coalitions, which Joseph alluded to. And these all have particular qualitative interests that will conflict with one another. As well, we have different intergovernmental departments, and this is rarely considered as politically, economically relevant. And just as an example, De Beers, I looked at their lobbying records. They don't just lobby the Prime Minister's office as kind of giving them a direct source into government, the Canadian government as a whole. They lobby Aboriginal Affairs and Northern Development. They lobby the Environment Canada. They lobby Natural Resources. They lobby Foreign Affairs. They lobby Industry Canada. They lobby all of these different departments because these all have consequences for their qualitative operations, which I'm arguing has consequences for their quantitative accumulation. So within all of these, there's cross-cutting conflictual interests. While quantitatively all of the corporations have the same interest in gain, qualitatively they will come into conflict. Now, considering De Beers' relationship with the UK during World War II, it was cooperative. De Beers was brought into the war effort. They were a key participant in export control. I noted already that the UK imposed stringent controls on the export of diamonds. Diamonds were very important industrially, as I said, for production. They were also an important source of currency control. So the UK is spending large amounts of money to support the war effort. And so there's a lot of pounds out in the world. By selling diamonds, it was one way of getting some of that money back. And De Beers worked closely with the government in these regards. They also worked to establish a new cutting industry in British Mandate Palestine. So when the Low Countries were occupied, that destroyed the main cutting center in Antwerp. And diamonds still needed to be cut. So the British government and De Beers worked together to establish this new cutting industry, which was a very delicate task, because the Belgian government in exile was located in the UK, and they expected that when the war was over, they would get back Antwerp as a cutting center. And as I mentioned, Belgian producers were participants in the De Beers cartel. And they also controlled the diamonds flowing out of the Belgian Congo. So they had to be appeased, both in the interest of the government and in the interest of De Beers. And again, they worked together to do that. Conversely, De Beers' relationship with the US was incredibly antagonistic. De Beers was suspected of smuggling to the Axis, and agents with the Office of Strategic Services, which was the predecessor to the CIA, investigating diamond smuggling in Africa, claimed to have evidence that this was happening. And I've looked at their records, and I've seen the claims that there's evidence, and I've seen very tentative evidence, but near as I can tell, they didn't have any solid evidence that this was happening. And in fact, I think this is where we can possibly locate how other logics can come to trump the logic of capitalization. Ernst Oppenheimer, who was the CEO of De Beers, his son, against Ernst's wishes and against his own power, served with the South African military during World War II and explicitly requested to serve on the front line. So it was in Ernst Oppenheimer's familial interest that the Allies win the war. And I think for that reason, he personally would want to ensure that the diamonds would not be smuggled to the Axis. Now, that's supposition. They were accused of hampering the war effort, as I mentioned, by the industrialists, and they were eventually charged as a trust by the Department of Justice. And these charges actually depended on claiming that De Beers advertising agency, NW Air, was effectively a part of the company, giving the US jurisdiction over De Beers. In fact, prior to the war, Ernst Oppenheimer had paid a visit to the Department of Justice about setting up operations in the US in the event of war. And he was effectively discerning if the company would be charged under antitrust legislation. And officials in the US expressed incredulity at his brazenness and sort of chalked it up to his Britishness, that this was evidence for how the British do business, all buddy-buddy between government and industry, where he didn't understand that in the US, markets and competition is sacrosanct. And certainly there was no way they were going to rubber stamp him running his anti-competitive cartel in the US. The British government actually also knew of this attempt, and they were concerned about the possibility of losing the diamond trade, which, as I mentioned, was this important source of foreign earnings. And possibly that was part of the reason they were willing to work so closely with De Beers in order to placate them. And finally, De Beers was defended by officials with the US Embassy in London. They spoke very highly of De Beers' participation in the war effort. So a member of the US Embassy was also part of this diamond committee because so many of the diamonds were being exported to the US. And they swore that De Beers is an honest participant in this whole thing. And because of that, they were ultimately not trusted by the Department of Justice. So returning to this. These qualitative events that I've described, comprising the shifting power of De Beers, have wide-ranging consequences. So consider just the diamond engagement ring tradition. It matters for many reasons beyond accumulation. These rings are important family heirlooms across North America. Diamond engagement rings were a highly visible part of the westernization of Japan. The tradition has maintained an environmentally destructive mining industry. However, these consequences are not distinct from the process of accumulation. And trying to understand the tradition according to the standard disciplinary categories or the standard bearer concepts within these categories will let us down. The tradition is not strictly cultural, nor will the aggregate political economic concepts of labor, capital, or state help. The differential accumulatory struggle by De Beers comprised an important part of the process of constructing the tradition. And De Beers' accumulation is the translation of many entities and events that comprised the emerging tradition. And that is why capitalist power calls for new concepts and new categories, and above all, much more empirically based research. Thank you.
Presenting is an art, and Troy, that was a true virtuoso performance. Thank you very much. So do we have any questions or comments from the audience, please? Yes.
I was just wondering if you could explain a little bit more what the business model of De Beers is. I don't know exactly if they're a cartel, but what do they control? How do they do it? I don't really know.
So De Beers Consolidated Mines, which is the name that you would see on the ads, was ostensibly a mining corporation. And they owned mines. But they also owned these two entities, the Diamond Corporation, or they owned most of the Diamond Corporation, and the Diamond Trading Corporation. The Diamond Corporation was owned primarily by them, partially by the South African government, and then small amounts were owned by other diamond mining companies. And this Diamond Corporation, they bought the supply of all of the mines. So they would buy De Beers Consolidated Mines output, and they would buy the output of all of the other participant mines. They also bought the output of alluvial miners in South Africa. So in South Africa, the alluvial fields, which is where the diamonds just lie on the surface or just shortly below the surface, was kind of an open prospector's game. And so you would have kind of like with Gold Rush type figures, they would work these plots to death. And they would sell it to the South African government, who would sell it to the Diamond Corporation. The Diamond Corporation would then sell the diamonds onto the Diamond Trading Corporation, who was the one that organized these sites. They're the ones who sorted all of the stones, graded everything, and controlled the flow of the stones out into the market. And De Beers Consolidated Mines had cross-cutting ownership in 20 different companies. Ernst Oppenheimer, part of De Beers Consolidated Mines was owned outright by Ernst Oppenheimer and his family. Part of it was owned by another entity called E. Oppenheimer and Sons, which was a privately held corporation. He was an early genius, shall we say, of kind of cross ownership that had emerged from his efforts to collapse the initial incarnation of the De Beers cartel when they refused to let him in. So Ernst Oppenheimer managed to buy up small diamond mines under all of these different names, so that no one knew that power was kind of consolidating, and once he had control of a large quantity of the stones, he used that to destroy the cartel, and then they brought him in and he reestablished it.
And their power is
they control today. At this no, but their power slowly waned from really this era on. And then it took a huge blow in the early 1980s when large sources of diamonds were discovered in Australia. And those diamond mines came under the control of Rio Tinto. And Rio Tinto refused to participate in the cartel. And so for about 20 years, the diamond trade was in a state where De Beers still controlled about half. And they were still using the same process. Well, Rio Tinto, on the other hand, they just sold as much as they possibly could. So De Beers was stabilizing the price. They would buy diamonds up if need be. So that was allowing Rio Tinto to just flood the market as much as they can. Well, De Beers was stockpiling stones. Then in 2001, they very publicly announced that they were ending this policy. They were going to sell off their famous stockpile of diamonds. And they were sort of announcing to Rio Tinto and others that we're now in a state of mutually assured destruction. So if you continue to sell diamonds endlessly, you're going to crater the price of these stones. And the fear has always been that if the price of stones fell, it was never coming back up. Because the illusion of diamonds as being valuable would be lost. If you're one day able to buy a 1-carat diamond for $100, are you going to turn around and buy it for $3,000 a year later? Probably not, because the mystique is gone. So that's why De Beers worked very hard to stabilize the price. They didn't want it to skyrocket. Because of diamond's durability, in theory, every gem ever mined is still out there somewhere. So their concern was if the price ever skyrocketed, all of these diamonds that are out there, people would be enticed to, well, I'm going to sell. Look how much diamonds are going for. And there's this idea that diamonds are a store of value. So people dump all of their diamonds onto the market, which then causes it to crater. And again, it's done. So they wanted to maintain a great deal of price stability.
I think run a long dialogue with you here, so maybe I'll start with one question. From reading your earlier writing and from watching this presentation, as I see it, the question that you are struggling with is, on the one hand, the universality of the quantities of differential accumulation, which are quantitative, unambiguous, by and large, and relatively easy to map. At the same time that you're saying that these universal quantities are underpinned by a set of shifting qualitative relationships, some of them could be quantified, but not in universal units. And then the challenge that faces you is how to link the quantities with the qualities. Now, my question is, is the barrier to that bridge to do with a lack of data? Or is it a methodological problem that needs to be rethought? And if it is a data problem, what data are you missing? In other words, what data would you like to have, and how would you think that such data could help you make that bridge or build that bridge? So these are, in fact, a few questions lumped into a single question, and whatever you can say about that will be useful.
Yeah. The data that are missing are qualitatively the mindsets, the daily translation of the mindsets of the market participants, who are the ones whose actions construct these things. And that I'm saying these constructions are not created out of thin air. They're very meaningful to them. The other is the quantitative aspect of that. When are they buying and selling these shares, and why? What are they responding to? What's causing this movement? Because a lot of what I describe, there's no way that they don't know it. And I'm not saying that there were market participants kind of sitting in the office of the Department of Justice while they're deciding whether or not to launch an antitrust lawsuit against De Beers. But I am saying that ultimately has consequences along some kind of material expressive relay that provokes that buying and selling action. So I'm missing a lot of steps in that relay, but I'm supposing they exist. I feel very strongly that they do exist. And I guess my methodological approach is kind of what I think is fairly strong quantitative evidence with a much more of a story on the qualitative side.
The data that you have plotted in this particular chart are pertaining to market capitalization, but
yeah,
we know that over long periods of time, and you do have a fairly long period stretched here in the chart, market valuation is fairly tightly correlated with profitability.
Sure.
So if you had a profit data for these entities, would that help you? If you had profits broken down, would that help you? The reason I'm asking is that sometimes research that we conduct is completely limited by the data we have access to, and then we are barred to think freely, to create, in your language, alternatives. And one way of trying to bypass that barrier and perhaps even make a sort of a positive contribution to the future is by saying, we need these data. We need these types of categories to be estimated, and government should do that and put it on paper. So in the future, at least there's some sort of a reference, what kind of a statistical infrastructure is absolutely necessary in order to answer those questions. So my question to you is, if you had whatever data you wanted, what would you want to know?
Yeah, I mean, I think, first of all, I'd want to know their actual sales figures. So I do have profit data for De Beers and the S&P 500. And just kind of in the most at the most abstract level, it looks exactly the same. So I've constructed the differential, it goes down, and then it jumps way up. Yeah. To me, that just moves the quantitative story one more step, but really I think it's the qualitative story that's the interesting part of this story. I think the larger point I'm making is kind of exemplifying sort of what's in capital's power, that these quantities are constructions rooted in diverse qualitative events. There's no singular determinant. And so I think the most interesting aspect of the story is all of the qualitative aspects to De Beers' accumulation. So the profits, absolutely, they help me tell this story. But then the question just becomes, where did those profits come from? Why did the profits rise in this period and fall in this period? So I think this story still has to be part of that.
I just want to close with that in case there are more questions. But methodologically, this is very interesting questions, I think, that you raise here. And I'm just wondering, we are running here into a problem that is not very different from the, or perhaps not very different from the problems that Marxist analysis run into with joint production processes, that we can't really identify the links between the different qualitative processes and the end result. But here, it's quite different because in joint production processes, we have many inputs and many outputs. Mm-hmm. And here we have many inputs, quote unquote, power inputs.
Yeah.
But we have a single output, actually.
Right.
So ostensibly, we should not logically be running into that problem, because if we are able to run some sort of a qualitative, quantitative regression, then we should be able to solve the problem. The question is, of course, do we want to run a regression?
Right.
But, I mean, these are fundamental methodological problems that have to be tackled if we are to push it forward. Because occasionally we do have quantitative measures for qualitative processes, and that makes life so much easier.
Right.
How are you going to address the problem when you have those qualitative issues that obviously are very important, but nevertheless are so elusive?
Right. Yeah, and I have tried, so I made reference to sort of how this quantity, this is the measure of capital, this is the measure of accumulation, which is the measure of power. This quantity sits at kind of the translational pinnacle of a whole bunch of information that it all gets kind of piled together and comes together, and you know, this is the emergent aspect of that. And in that compilation, there's all kinds of quantitative moments. I mean, you don't have, the brokers aren't sitting with stacks and stacks of newspaper. They're sitting with many, many reports, which are tons and tons of quantities involved in them. And I guess in some ways, I try to replicate that by looking for quantifiable moments in this qualitative morass that I'm discovering, which can serve as sort of clarifying points, because I cannot tell the entire story, because in some ways the entire story of this is the entire world, because diamonds are being unfolded all over the place. So I have to pick my moments, and some, like the marriage image. or say this image, the importance of industrial stones, gives me a quantitative representation for how industrial stones are becoming important in De Beers' control of those stones. Obviously, this lent itself to their accumulation. But I don't think it's possible to, I know it's not possible to reduce the accumulation of De Beers down to these quantities. I don't want to, for methodological reasons, for kind of ontological reasons, and also just simply for reasons of personal interest, because the qualitative aspects of this change to me are extremely important, and political economy has a history of eliminating those sorts of things in favor of a quantitative reduction. So I think an impressionistic image of how these quantities relate is important and illustrative, but it's really at its most illustrative conjoined with the qualitative tale. Figure two.
So this might be a little naive, but I found figure two very interesting in terms of De Beers not cashing out on that marriage and couple psychology in the post-war era.
Right.
And I wanted you to maybe address why they chose, I mean, you mentioned they chose to stabilize. They didn't choose to kind of cash out on it. And that was for, obviously, for power consolidation. So maybe you can tell us how that power manifested itself, or like what kind of what conclusions that drew.
Sorry, I didn't totally follow.
So the reason those spikes exist,
yeah,
are because there was a capital accumulation for cut stones because they were bought for marriage purposes, right? But De Beers didn't do that. They didn't cash in right in the post-war era.
Right.
So that was for power consolidation. That's what you mentioned. Maybe you can talk about how that power manifested itself.
So this, there's no spike in the U.S. import of rough stones because this isn't just up to De Beers. I mean, they controlled the supply, but they couldn't make anyone buy it. And I think it has a lot to do just with the time lag. I mean, cutting a diamond takes time. So the war is over. You have diamond cutters who've been able to return home. They have large quantities of cut stones they haven't really been able to sell, at least of their own volition. And so there's a demand and a ready-made supply of cut stones that are out there. So De Beers really didn't have the option to capitalize on it. I mean, you can see there's still a slight increase, but they weren't able to just jump right on that. And it obviously, for that year, mattered. But I think the more important point is that in years to come, the U.S. import of rough stones continues to climb, even while the marriage rate falls, and that's because a growing share of engagement rings were now diamonds. So where previously it was about one-third, in the post-war era, it was one-half to two-thirds. So they didn't capitalize at that point just because they couldn't. They lacked the relationships that would allow them to exercise that sort of power.
Thank you very much, Troy. My question is about the first figure, so you may want to bring that up.
Yep.
So this is me just essentially eyeballing what would, I guess, be the differential of De Beers to South African mines.
Yeah.
Kind of just on a quick eyeball, it seems that almost for this entire period, from 1899 all the way up until 1950, maybe with the exception of 1919 to 1929 or 39, that is differentially accumulated relative to South African mines.
Yeah.
Just sort of two questions. One, what does South African mines consist of, or who, I guess, is part of that index? And could you maybe give some comments on that relationship between De Beers and South African mines? Maybe in part because most of us sort of identify De Beers as a South African company.
Right. I think De Beers, although it's a mining company and it has tight relationships with Anglo-American, which was also started by Ernest Oppenheimer, it's quite different from other mining companies, which are resource extraction firms first, and the product that they sell is almost entirely destined for industry. And the South African mining index would be almost entirely dominated by gold mining companies. The particular reasons for their stagnation over this period, I'm not 100% sure. Could be with gold prices.
That's entirely
The work that Shimshon and I have done on South Africa focused really on the gold sector, and there you can see that gold production has a very pronounced historical cycle of increase and then a massive decrease. So it's an inverted U shape.
Yeah.
And most of the changes in gold income and therefore gold profit are related to the price of gold. So
right.
I wouldn't be surprised, again, that's off the top of my head, that South African mines as an index would be heavily influenced by the price of gold.
Right. And I mean, this is obviously another important difference with De Beers. I can't find long historical records for the prices of rough stones, but it's safe to assume that they're very stable because those De Beers specifically controls. I mean, they were stabilizing the price of cut stones, which they don't control. They're certainly stabilizing the cut of the price of rough stone. So price does not correlate with De Beers accumulation like it has with other companies that you've looked at.
Yes, I have another question that is related to that, and this is just for clarification. Because De Beers, if I remember correctly, and correct me if I'm wrong, was an owner of Anglo-American and vice versa, so there was cross-ownership. To what extent does the profit of the beer reflect the profits of Anglo-American?
At this point, they don't own a large amount of it. I mean, it gets murky in the fact that they are owned partially by this E. Oppenheimer's and son, who also owns part of Anglo-American and is controlling it, and there is some cross-ownership. But they own a pretty negligible amount of Anglo-American themselves.
Troy, you said something along the lines of diamonds being participants in their own sourcing.
Right.
That to me sounds like an inscrutable postulate, because diamonds are passive objects. So how could they be participating in anything? What do you mean when you say that sentence?
It's very kind of you, Joseph. Feed me for the slide that I skipped. So on the previous one, I said that the categories into which diamonds are sorted are not natural, but neither are they strictly social. This occurs as a dialogue between them. And as well as being participants in the sort, I think they have to be considered participants in advertising and industry. And I think to understand that, we need to distinguish between the properties of a thing and the capacities of a thing. So its properties are fixed. The density of diamonds was the density of diamonds before dinosaurs were here, and they will continue to be the density of diamonds after we're here, assuming gravity remains what it is. Their atomic structure is fixed. So diamond is a particular array of carbon atoms that has emerged as the result of certain ingredients coming together under the right heat and pressure conditions. Once that arrangement is in place, that's it. Capacities are a very different thing. So a diamond has a capacity to signify marital intent and status. It also has the capacity to cut steel. So its properties of hardness, clarity, and brilliance have been enrolled in the ad copy that has been part of creating the diamond tradition. And so although the properties are fixed, once a diamond becomes part of this assemblage, a capacity emerges. So that capacity is not just there in the diamond all by itself, but neither is it just in us all by itself. We have to come together for this emergence to occur. In the same way, it's not a property of the diamond that it can cut steel. It's a capacity of it. It has to be brought into contact with steel under the proper conditions for that to be actualized. So that's what I mean. You can't reduce that act. So when you bring the diamond into contact with the steel and it cuts it, that act can't be reduced to say, well, that's a human act. It's an act of humans and diamonds in assemblage with the actualization of the capacity of the diamond to cut steel. I mean, we also have the capacity to cut steel, provided we're in the proper assemblage. So that's what I mean, that they're participants in this. So the diamond sorter, they're looking at the stone, and the stone is saying certain things to them. Now, that absolutely is fixed, but the categories that they're bringing to bear on it, it's the sorter and the diamond together in relationship to the category that produces its categorization. It's not just in the diamond, which is what the industry would claim, but neither is it just in the sorter themselves.
But I still don't know why that justifies using the term participant, because by using the word participant, you seem to be imputing some kind of singular quality to diamonds. But what you've just said now suggests that diamonds only have a capacity once they've been socially constructed in some way or another. So I'm a bit mystified about
this. Well, I don't know why, they only have a capacity once they've been constructed in one way or another. But it's not strictly a social construction, because the diamonds themselves are part of that construction. And I don't think you would say that the diamond itself is social through and through.
But it only finds meaning and only has value once it's been mediated by social relations. So by calling it a participant, you're not actually giving adequate attention to that process of mediation.
No, I'm absolutely giving trying to pay attention to that process of mediation by not eliminating the diamond from that process.
Also, you seem to be very squeamish in regard to reductionism. But for me, science is reductionism. And I think the danger of being so squeamish is that what we are left with is a quasi-post-structuralist analysis of the diamond industry adorned with really great-looking charts. I would encourage you to be more reductionist in your analysis.
Okay.
But that's my view.
I did 2 degrees in reductionism. I've had more than my fill of it.
I have a question about the... about advertising again. Advertising now is very quantitative, like, firms will say, well, if we spend this much, we think in advertising, we think we can increase sales by this much. And they do all kinds of research. Is there any way to link, say, the advertising, quantitatively, the advertising done by De Beers with the change in purchasing habits of buyers in terms of, you know, gems per marriage, you know? That would be very interesting for me to if that could be established.
Absolutely, and it's tempting. However, given that I can just point qualitatively to the fact that here, the advertising began. It was zero before this, and now there's a massive jump in it. And partway through the war, it dropped off a bit, and then it expanded again. But I already know this data. And I know that the advertisement, the kind of force of the advertisement, how prevalent the advertisement was, if I were to count the ads, count up, you know, add the circulation and try to estimate how many people were seeing that, it's going to go like this. At the most, it's going to go like this. Well, meanwhile, the sales are going like that. So I already know, I mean, I might be wrong. Maybe if I were to look at it, I'm totally misunderstanding this. And even though they were advertising, no one was looking at those ads. But I don't think so. I think I have enough qualitative information to tell me that that's not the case. Now, in terms of the quantification that the advertising agency is doing, absolutely. And on the one hand, going back to Jonathan's point, if I were looking at kind of the contemporary diamond market, the data I would absolutely want is the data that the advertising agencies have, the marketing data that they're doing. For this period, although they are doing some quantification, it hasn't come anywhere near the level that it is now. And I can look through the records of the available records of their advertising agency, and there will be a few quantifications here and there, but nothing that I can construct a reasonable series out of.
Why De Beers? Why wouldn't you pick any other conglomerate from the contemporary period? Wouldn't your life be so much easier to illustrate the conversion of qualities to quantities if you do that with something like General Electric or General Motors or any other contemporary firm with a history that has plenty of material to work with? You don't have to be a detective and to beg for data and information and excavate archives.
Wouldn't I?
Well, maybe less, because you're dealing here with information that is actually quite secret. I mean, these corporations do not necessarily put forward the information that you might want to. Maybe not. Maybe I'm wrong. I'm basically asking you to explain to us what is special, what is revealing about De Beers, or is this just a historical accident that you picked De Beers for different reasons and ended up with this kind of investigation? There are people here that might think about their own research, and I'm just thinking maybe it would be useful for you to tell a little bit about the history of your research,
right,
to give them an indication how did you get there.
So my background is in economics. I did 2 degrees in just full-on neoclassical economics. And I went into economics in part because I wanted to understand how these economic systems functioned. And if anyone's taken any economics courses, you know that economics doesn't help you understand how real-world economies function. And so when I started my PhD, which is in social and political thought, that was my intention. I wanted to understand how real-world economies function. And I discovered the work of Jonathan and Shimshon. He was here. It's part of the reason I came here. I felt like this framework is a way that I can investigate how actual business actually functions in the actual world, opposed to the fictions of economics. And I didn't have kind of a clear-cut target. I had this sort of amorphous idea of looking at technological change, innovation, blah, blah, blah. My program has a graduate conference every year. And because we're an interdisciplinary program, the topic of the conference is always something really broad and amorphous. And 1 year, the topic was love. And it's a great conference. Because it's interdisciplinary, you have people from all different backgrounds. You have to talk to each other. And so they actually talk to each other in very comprehensible terms, strangely, for an academic conference. So I wanted to participate. And I was just like, well, what could I do that's political economy, which is what I thought of what I was doing at the time, and love? I was like, well, how about diamonds? So I constructed a quick and dirty chart, which was an early version of this, to see what the differential accumulation of De Beers had been, discovered roughly this, and also learned that De Beers started advertising in 1939. And so here was my presentation. De Beers had this differential accumulatory upswing at the same time that it started advertising. Ipso facto, advertising was how they made their accumulatory gains. And subsequent research showed me that that was a hasty conclusion and that there was a much more complicated thing going on here. I'd already started the research on De Beers. I kind of stuck with it. I was incredibly interested in the era. And in some ways, I thought it would be easy because I have one company, one commodity. That's it. You have diamonds and De Beers. De Beers controls almost the entire trade of this one thing. GE has five divisions, and each division has hundreds of product lines. And so I thought the excavation of that would just, as complex as this was, it would just be multiplied 100 times. So a big part of what I'm doing is trying to develop what I think business studies rooted in accumulation would look like. So there is business studies that exists, but it largely takes place within business schools. So it's not done with the same sort of critical perspective, where I think it's divorced from understanding that the goal of these businesses is accumulation. And I think capital's power provides the tools and the analytical understanding to make sense of what that accumulation is, that this is a process of power distribution among these powerful entities. Where does that accumulation come from, I think, is a massive qualitative question. Are there easier qualitative answers for that question? Possibly, but right now, it requires something like this, which is a much more impressionistic story of these arenas that De Beers is participating in, I'm arguing, in order to expand and stabilize the relationships that constitute its power. Can you pass the mic down? James, down.
I guess this question is born out of complete ignorance. What are blood diamonds and what is De Beers' involvement with them?
So blood diamonds refers to stones that have been mined in war zones, often using slave labor. And in fact, De Beers was an important force behind the Kimberley process, which was a process of verifying the source of diamonds to kind of tell people that you're not buying a blood diamond, you're not supporting some rebel militia that's cutting off people's hands. So often when I tell people I'm researching De Beers, they're immediately like, oh, blood diamonds, I didn't buy a diamond from De Beers. And I was like, well, if you would have bought a diamond from De Beers, you actually wouldn't have bought a blood diamond, because De Beers is interested in supply control. Any means to keep diamonds off the market, they're all for it.
What was it called? The Kimberley?
The Kimberley process was a way of verifying the origins of diamonds. Now, there is some evidence that diamonds have moved from these war zones into De Beers-controlled zones, where De Beers then kind of rubber stamps them as being their own. But for the most part, they're fine with excluding a set of stones from the market.
Thank you, Troy. Great presentation. I'm just wondering, perhaps this is silly, but is there ever the danger of running out of diamonds to mine?
Yeah.
Is this a finite resource, right? So
yeah.
How much is there? Do you have any stats on that or any?
I don't know the specific amount, but I've been in contact with Thomas Stachel, who is one of the world's leading diamond researchers, and he's actually at the University of Alberta. And I asked him about that, and he said, absolutely. The quantity of natural diamonds is dwindling. The location of new sources of diamonds has fallen way, way off, and they're not locating new sources. It's part of the reason why Canada has been so exciting, despite the fact that these diamonds are in incredibly inhospitable areas. So De Beers has been playing, or well, less De Beers and more Rio Tinto, has been playing an important role in developing wind technology that can operate in sub-zero temperatures, because they want the power to power the mines that are operating in these harsh conditions, because they're sick of having to bring in all of the diesel fuel on winter roads.
But it's still possible to create artificial diamonds for industry, right?
It's unclear what size you could create. The vast majority of industrial diamonds now are manufactured, and most of that manufacturing is done by De Beers.
Thanks.
Another background question. If you can speak about your archival research and describe what it might entail, that's the first question. Again, might be of interest to some of the people present. And secondly, if you can think of some moments in which you discovered something really important or something that completely surprised you, that would be interesting.
So this is based on accessing really three archives, the US government's archives, the UK government's archives, and then the archives of NWAIR, which are now housed at the Smithsonian. And if anyone is interested in history, I highly recommend archival research. It's pretty amazing to go and just handle these documents, even if they're very dry, seemingly arcane documents. Just the handwriting that's in the margins, I really enjoy that sort of research. In terms of what it's revealed that's surprising, it's always kind of a crapshoot, because you have a certain idea of what's going on here. So I said in the broadest terms, I believed that this gain, that was their advertising. Started advertising, gained advertising. That's the explanation for it. And I read a couple books on De Beers, and in those books, they claimed very strongly that, in fact, De Beers had smuggled diamonds to the Access, and they cited this archival material. And once I went and looked at the archival material and continued to read things, that's when I learned, well, actually, Harry Oppenheimer, who would eventually become CEO of De Beers, served on the front lines for the Allies, and the supposed evidence of this smuggling, it just wasn't there. So as much as I was more than ready to vilify De Beers, I had to accept that there's a very good chance that despite the fact the profits were possibly there, they did not smuggle diamonds to the Access. And in fact, they made efforts to secure the diamonds, which they themselves were concerned about, because the occupation of the lowlands meant that the family members of the mine, Belgian mine executives, were living in occupied territories. So they were continually concerned that these executives could be blackmailed to themselves smuggle diamonds to the Access. So it's possible that was one trickling source, but De Beers were themselves concerned with that, obviously, because illicit diamond buying, which is what the trade in smuggled stones is called, was contrary to their interests.
Thanks, Troy. When you do research, are you only researching one thing at a time, or do you often have a few projects going?
A few projects going.
And I'm also wondering, there's just, I guess, questions about doing research. Is it often the case that you'll have a hypothesis and do a lot of work on creating the hypothesis and then have trouble finding the research to back it up and then have to scrap the entire thing?
Absolutely. So, I mean, I had this hypothesis about the effect of advertising on De Beers' accumulation and the figures that I could find to kind of represent what De Beers' sales were. They did not correspond at all. I also tried to look at the relative spending on diamonds compared to other sort of luxuries, which is difficult to discern from US statistical sources. And once I had sort of constructed this measure of luxury spending, the spending on diamonds was no greater. I thought perhaps during the war, it would be relatively greater. So while luxury spending in general was maybe falling, relative to that falling luxury spending, diamonds would be gaining, but no, they just, no real relationship. So if it's a science, you can always fail.
Another question here. I was just wondering, is De Beers was a cartel. So does that mean they owned all the other diamond suppliers at the time, or was there a competitor to De Beers?
Them being a cartel meant they marketed the vast majority of the diamonds, about 90%. So they did own a lot of the mining companies, but there were some other mines that then they just sold their diamonds to De Beers.
Okay. And lastly, when Australia discovered their abundance of diamonds and Rio Tinto came about, were the United States very willing to buy up the diamonds from a different source than De Beers because they were limited during World War II to the supply of diamonds coming from De Beers?
I haven't looked that much at that era because I've already inundated with qualitative data for just this short period of time. That discovery of diamonds would have done some reordering to the diamond trade in general because De Beers would have sort of held their buyers hostage, saying, if you buy diamonds from Rio Tinto, you're not buying diamonds from us anymore. That became much less and less a concern as the Australian source expanded and new sources were found, so you could kind of walk away from De Beers. So as far as the US was concerned, they didn't give a shit. As far as kind of the cutting industry, this definitely was a boon for them. Perhaps the most famous person who walked away from De Beers was Harry Winston. So Harry Winston was probably the best known name in diamond jewelry design. And he eventually had enough of De Beers' dominance. And so his response was to buy his own mine that became the source of stones for Harry Winston.
So, first of all, that was a fascinating research, and I truly enjoyed it. My question is in regards to De Beers, and how have they influenced our own consumption habits today in terms of advertising, what we perceive of diamonds, love, etc. Just if you can just give us a tiny scope on how they've influenced us in our consumption habits.
So here's actually a surprising thing I discovered. More surprising than what I said before. So NW Air was De Beers' advertising agency. And beyond just making the ads, they were doing what they called publicity. And so this would be things like an opera house in New York, a selection of seats in the opera house, box seats in the opera house, was called the Diamond Quarter. And NW Air kind of latched onto this thing, and at the launch of each opera season, they would distribute a map of the Diamond Quarter telling you which kind of prestigious New York family was sitting in which box. And then they began to work with those families to provide them with diamonds, so they would also tell them, what kind of diamonds they're wearing. Especially making the point of how much that was worth. Because that's our fascination with diamonds, that this little glittery stone is worth so much. And it still happens. If you watch the stars walking the red carpet for the Oscars, you often hear that they're wearing a necklace worth $2 million. And even those of us who think we're savvy and can scoff at it, I think it's hard to deny that there's something fascinating about that. But De Beers, NW Air, they also... Other companies that were advertising with them, they would subsidize their ad if the ad copy could refer to their product as the diamond whatever. So this is the diamond of soaps. This is the diamond of dishwashing detergents. Because that helps construct this idea that diamond means quality. So it's a much more pervasive process of kind of constructing the mythology of diamonds than simply what was going on in the advertisements. And the effect of that, I think it's had an effect. I think it's the reason why, we have a diamond cab company. What do diamonds have to do with cabs? But we all know what they're trying to imply with that name, and that just maintains this idea that, well, diamond means quality.
Thanks. I'm just wondering, because diamonds are so durable, luxury ones anyway, and they last for such a long time, is there a large secondhand diamond market, and how does that fit into the monopoly of De Beers?
There is not a large secondhand market. If anyone's interested, I highly recommend an article by Edward J. Epstein. It's widely available online, called Have You Ever Tried to Sell a Diamond? And it documents what the consequences have been of De Beers' efforts to prevent the emergence of a secondhand diamond market, in part because they've really played with the idea of diamonds as a store of value. So the ads will kind of intimate that you buy this thing and it will maintain its value and could be a source of returns later down the road. But obviously, they don't really want people to sell those stones, which is part of the reason why it's been so important to maintain such a stable price, because there are so many diamonds out there. That's why it's so important to make it a sentimental object. You don't want to sell grandma's diamond engagement ring, do you? No, you heartless bastard. So you hold on to that, and it keeps it within the families and not flooding onto the secondhand market. So I didn't talk about it, but I only talked about kind of the areas where De Beers succeeded in expanding and stabilizing its relationships, not where it failed. And one example of where it failed is an effort to entice men to wear brown diamonds. So at the same time as they started their advertising campaign for engagement rings, they also started a campaign aimed at kind of wealthier men to wear brown diamond rings, brown diamond tie clips, brown diamond lapel pins. And obviously that never took off. And just in the course of my research, I was curious. I was like, oh, maybe I could try to acquire one of these brown diamond pieces, because they must exist out there. And now they're vintage objects that cost thousands of dollars. It's ludicrous.
So I guess originally I was going to ask about the duality of diamonds being this almost very this very valuable object and this very highly sought after object in comparison to the fact that diamonds are actually used in industrial manufacturing, and they're actually used for grunt work in factories and in production. So could you talk about a bit about the duality between the two, and maybe why aren't the fact that they're used in industrial production, why hasn't that demystified them a bit?
Because I think to most people's ideas, these are very different sorts of diamonds. I'm sure most people, if they hear the term industrial diamond, if they have any image at all, it's probably not of a cut stone. And I think if anything, it kind of adds to the mystique. Here you have this glamorous thing, but you put it in the right tool and it will, tear a piece of steel to shreds. And people are fascinated by the fact that you can scratch glass with a diamond. I think it's all part of actually augmenting its mystique.
And we were talking about diamond. You were talking about diamonds as a store of value, and apparently there's not a big market for secondhand diamonds. Now, you were saying that diamonds were, in a sense, meant to they last a long time, and they're meant to maintain value. But wouldn't people notice, I guess, if they tried to turn around and sell a diamond, that it really doesn't hold that much value?
People,
I don't know if you really
tried,
get what I'm trying to say.
People who've tried to sell diamonds have noticed exactly that.
Yeah, so doesn't that bring down the appeal of diamonds as this store of value? And as this, as this store of value.
But the instances of that, they haven't reached the same sort of critical mass as the onslaught of us hearing about the stars wearing all of these diamonds. There's just much more kind of cultural discourse that augments our impression of diamonds as valuable than there is the sort of undermining it. You get this, I think people who think of themselves as intelligent and socially knowledgeable, we all know that diamonds don't have, diamonds aren't as valuable as what gets charged for them. One of the conclusions I've come to is that nothing has any kind of inherent value whatsoever. It's all a complex construction, diamonds as well as anything else. I mean, ethically, we might question diamonds more than, the price of this chair, but both are equally a construction.
Any other questions or comments? Okay, well, that brings our speaker series to an end. The speaker Okay, so that brings our speaker series to an end. The speaker series showcased some of the exciting new ways in which the capitalist power framework is evolving, but more importantly, it has shown the potency of independent research. And I hope to see some of the audience members here today presenting their own research in the near future. Thank you.